We've been partnering with Facebook to build out that technology, to refine that technology, and I'm excited right now to introduce to you Facebook's head of business intelligence, Guy Bays. He's going to talk a little bit more about the role that MicroStrategy plays in their architecture.
Hello, everybody. I'm Guy Bays. I run business intelligence at Facebook. And I will be your favorite presentation of the day because I will be the shortest. I wanted to talk a little bit about some of the interesting things that we've been doing with MicroStrategy. And I also wanted to explain a little bit about how it could be relevant in the rest of the world. So this is Facebook. A billion point one, I think, users as of a couple days ago, connected all over the world. It's an amazing data platform to work on, and it's been an honor to be part of the company for the last 2 years. So I've worked a lot of different places. Started off, actually almost exactly 15 years ago, I started my data warehousing career at a small startup that was a spin-off of CBS, NBC Interactive, actually. I've worked for big broadcasters, I worked for CNET, I worked for internet companies, I worked for crazy government research labs. I've kind of been all over the place and I've seen a lot of data. So an interesting story, when I started my career in data warehousing 15 years ago, we were rolling out the very first data warehouse I ever worked on. It was a clickstream data warehouse. It was associated with CNET. It was, I think, 600 gigabytes total. And at that time, there was a whole lot of debate about whether you could actually do traditional data warehousing against clickstream data. I remember us all sitting around like, 600 gigabytes, it's huge. You know, how are we going to handle this volume? You think about the growth projections, it could be a terabyte within a year. And it was just like a mind-blowing experience. So now you fast forward, Facebook, today. And so I started 2 years ago at Facebook. I get my Unix account. I'm getting all set up to be able to do actual development if I ever find the time. And I join all the distribution lists that you're supposed to join in order to be aware of the things that are going on at Facebook. One of the distribution lists I joined was the Hadoop user distribution list. It's a pretty active distribution list. And I remember that one of the first messages I got when I was at Facebook as part of that distribution list was a maintenance message from the Hadoop admins. One of the things that's interesting about Hadoop is when you delete data in Hadoop, if you configure it this way, which we do, you don't actually delete the data. It's just like a PC. You move it over into your trash directory. And so managing the trash directory of this big Hadoop cluster was one of the things that the Hadoop maintenance guys were always pretty concerned about. So this message that they sent out to me was, you know, we usually keep the trash directory around for 7 days. It's starting to use up a fair amount of space. We're getting a little concerned about it. We're probably going to decrease the window of purging of the trash directory to 3 days. And if we think that if we do that, we're going to save ourselves 6 petabytes of disk. So I remember I just like looked at this. 6 petabytes in the trash directory. It's like 4 days of trash is 6 petabytes. So that was, at that point in time, that trash directory, that four days of trash was like the biggest data environment I'd ever seen. And so I started asking questions. It turns out that our Hadoop cluster at that point in time was 100 petabytes, and today it's 200. So it's kind of interesting that over that 15-year period, we've gone from 600 gigabytes being a huge environment up to like 200 petabytes being a huge environment. So one of the things that I really took away from that was that things change. And as IT leaders and as technology leaders, it's one of our jobs to get ahead of the change and be aware of what's happening and to manage it for our enterprises. So, enter MicroStrategy. Facebook had a pretty long relationship with MicroStrategy. Saylor has always been a big fan of the company and, you know, had gotten involved with us at a pretty early area. But when I started up, we were mostly using them for sales reporting and finance and management dashboards. We had not really taken a crack at turning MicroStrategy against the main data sources that power Facebook, the user data and the activity data. And it was actually a really similar conversation to the one that I'd had 15 years ago with the first clickstream data warehouses. Can we handle the volume? Will it be big enough? You know, how in the world can we deal with the growth rates? So we had this conversation with MicroStrategy and we're like, you know, we're really kind of skeptical. We don't know whether we can get this to work with your current state of technology, but you know, we're a risk-taking culture. We're more than happy to partner with you on this. We think that we can, you know, either be successful or we'll fail, and we'll fail pretty hard, and we'll fail pretty fast, and we'll learn a lot from it. And so the thing that really impressed me about MicroStrategy is they're also a risk-taking culture. They're able to take intelligent risks, which is kind of a rare thing in an enterprise software vendor. And so they jumped all over this, and they're like, let's go do this. You know, we don't know whether we can do it or not, but let's try. Let's see what happens. So 3 months later, we have this thing that's running that's one of the most amazing things I've ever seen. So it's running against the entire Facebook user base, 1.1 billion users, you know, everything about their demographics, where they live, what they like, you know, on Facebook. It's running in seconds and it's running in memory. And this is due primarily to this collaborative risk-taking adventure that we went on with MicroStrategy. Another thing that was really impressive is we were sitting around, you know, 3 or 4 months after it, we're getting ready to demo this, and somebody from the user side said, hey, wouldn't it be great if we could put this thing on mobile? Is there any way we could get it to run on iPad? Because, you know, we're going to do this big demo with our customer council. Rather than, like, have a bunch of laptops, we could just hand iPads around to them. So we went to MicroStrategy and we talked to them about it. You know, how much work is it to put it on iPad? And 2 weeks later, there it was, you know. So only BI vendor I know that could pull something like that off. You know, complete iPad implementation in two weeks, you know, live to end users, running against an in-memory source that had like 1.1 billion rows in it. So if you think about where this fits into our architecture, Facebook actually has a lot of BI platforms and a lot of data stores. We are by no means a homogeneous, you know, single source of truth, one big platform environment. And I think that that's going to be the case more and more across the industry. As analytical tools become more complex and as this huge open source innovation is happening, you're getting more and more pieces in your pie. So it's not just like a one big EDW anymore. MicroStrategy plays this really key role in that you can have a huge in-memory environment that can pull data from all over your ecosystem and serve it all up in a relatively short amount of time. So we've kind of embraced this at Facebook. We've said, you know, the reality is that there will be more than one analytical platform in the company. And so we have a project, a sort of umbrella we call Legos, which is how are we going to stitch all this together. MicroStrategy's highly distributed cubes is a really important part of that philosophy. So why do you care? Well, one thing that you're getting kind of for free out of this partnership is we're basically your QA department. We've been kicking the tires on this thing for like a year, and we'll kick the tires on it for another year, which means that by the time Sailor and MicroStrategy get around to rolling it out as a GA, we will have hopefully found not only a lot of the bugs, but we'll have pushed a lot of the scalability limits. So I think that when this MPP in-memory architecture goes live to you, it's going to be a very surprisingly mature product. You know, and I'm writing checks for MicroStrategy. I can see people like, you know, kind of cringing over there in the background. But I think you'll have 2 years of Facebook R&D basically beating the crap out of it before you see it, which should make it a pleasant experience for everyone. The other thing I'd like to say is that we are only 1% done with this. I mean, the plans we have for this environment are huge. You know, it's been a huge hit at Facebook. There's a lot of pent-up demand. We're starting to explore all sorts of interesting things that we're going to do with it. So the things that we're showing you today are just the beginning of the iceberg. We have this risk-taking adventure that we've been doing with MicroStrategy has only just begun. So that's my story. I promised you it would be short. I hope you all have a good day, and thank you so much for having me here.